Hi everyone, welcome to Pal to Tech. Today we're talking about image stabilization for Fujifilm cameras. Obviously, the goal of any kind of stabilization is to ensure that your photos remain as sharp as possible as you approach those slower shutter speeds. Now, before camera manufacturers created lens stabilization mechanisms and IBIS systems, many photographers used the good old-fashioned, time-tested Reciprocal Rule. That rule states that to avoid blur from camera shake, you want to always keep your shutter speed at least 1 over the focal length of the lens rounded up. So for example, if you're using a 56mm lens, your minimum shutter speed should be 1/56th of a second, which rounded up is 1/60th of a second on the dial. Therefore, if you're using a 56mm lens, shooting photos at 1/60th of a second handheld, in theory, you should be able to avoid introducing camera shake blur into your shots. However, the Reciprocal Rule applies to full frame sensors. When you factor in an APS-C cropped sensor camera, such as the Fujifilm X-T3 or X-T4, you need to multiply the Reciprocal Rule by that camera's crop factor. So for example, the Fujifilm X-T3 and X-T4 sensor has a full frame crop factor of roughly 1.5. Therefore, if you're shooting with a 56mm lens, you would multiply 56 times 1.5 to get 84. So the minimum shutter speed you would want to use to avoid handheld camera shake would be 1/84th of a second, which means in the real world, I'd set the shutter speed to 1/100th of a second, or I would just rotate the shutter dial to 1/25th of a second. And remember, if you're using a zoom lens, your focal length will change, right? If you are zoomed all the way in, say to 1/40, then you are going to need a faster minimum shutter speed than you would if you zoomed back out at, say, 50 on the same lens. Now, this doesn't take into account subject motion, which I'll discuss toward the end of this video. Now, there are all kinds of other factors that come into play, and this is not an exact science. The way that you hold your camera, your body posture, the way you even breathe while you're taking the shot, even your camera's sensor resolution, all of those factors can contribute to your need for a minimum required shutter speed to avoid camera shake blur. And so because of this, camera manufacturers have introduced the concept of in-camera or in-lens image stabilization that gets applied automatically while you're shooting. Now, the first thing to remember is that there are several different types of stabilization. The first is called three-legged stabilization, right? Otherwise known as tripod stabilization. I mention this one first because I think some photographers kind of forget this option, right? And when it comes to stabilization, nothing beats getting your camera firmly locked down onto a tripod as the best way to stabilize your image. Sorry. I just had to say that. Now, the second kind of stabilization is called lens stabilization. Now, the way you can tell if a lens has built-in stabilization is via the OIS marking right here on the lens itself. You see that here? If you see OIS, then this means that the lens contains gyroscopic sensors that are constantly calculating the direction that the lens is moving. Basically, if you unintentionally slightly move the lens one direction, the stabilization system inside the lens moves it the other direction and sort of cancels out the movement to keep the image sharp. This works wonderfully when shooting video on longer focal length lenses, such as the 50 to 140mm. For example, take a look at this. The video footage on the left was shot with OIS turned off. The video on the right has OIS turned on. Look at the difference here. All I did was flip the OIS switch on the 50 to 140mm lens. That's it. The gyroscopic sensors inside the lens took care of the rest. Speaking of the 50 to 140mm zoom, according to Fuji, you can lower your shutter speed using this lens all the way down to 1/4 of a second. Basically, that gives you 5 additional stops of lowered shutter speed. Take a look at these two images right here. Both of them were shot with the 50 to 140mm lens with the exact same settings. The only difference was that on the photo on the right, I turned on image stabilization. have a look at this. You see that? It makes a huge difference. The area that controls image stabilization in the menu is located in the camera icon right at the bottom. Now you see how it has IS mode off. That's because I had it turned off on the lens. If I switch it back on, have a look at this. It appears, you see that? So now you can go into IS mode and you can choose either continuous or shooting only. If you have it on continuous, that means that while the camera's on at all times, the lens is constantly applying image stabilization. If you have it in shooting only, it will only start to apply image stabilization when you half press down the shutter button and begin to take your shot. Obviously, if you leave it on continuous, it will use more battery life. The third type of stabilization is called in-body image stabilization, commonly referred to as IBIS. Now, this is very different from lens stabilization. Instead of the gyroscopic sensors moving the lens parts around, the camera uses an IBIS mechanism that moves the entire sensor around to counteract unintended movements. Now, IBIS-equipped cameras are not very common in the Fujifilm world. Currently, the X-T4, X-H1, and XS10 do offer IBIS. When you have a camera that offers IBIS, you basically get some form of image stabilization to any lens that you use, whether it's a Fujifilm OIS lens, a non-OIS lens such as this 35mm prime, or perhaps a third-party lens such as this Rokinon or this Viltrox 56mm. So for example, I shot both of these photos with the Viltrox 56mm lens and they are exactly the same settings. The only difference is that on the photo on the right, I turned on IBIS on the X-T4. So here I am at 1/60th of a second, both photos, you see that right there. Here I am at 1/30th of a second, and look at this. Dropping down to 1/15th of a second, now I have camera shake blur. You see that? But it's not as affected by IBIS. Here is 1/8th of a second. Have a look at this. Handheld just like this at 1/8th of a second. Without the IBIS mechanism, the photo on the left is useless. Okay, now we're down to 1/4 of a second here. So even with the IBIS turned on, I'm starting to get some camera shake blur. You see that right there? But you could still use it. If you zoom out, I mean, it's a fairly usable image. And finally, have a look at half a second handheld. Without IBIS, forget about it. With IBIS, yeah, there's a little bit, but overall, you could still have a better time of rescuing this image in post-production. And this makes IBIS the perfect companion for shooting video. Often, you'll want to use cinema lenses or other third-party video lenses that don't offer OIS. And this is where the X-T4 really excels at being able to support those kinds of lenses using the IBIS mechanism on the camera. Now, according to Fuji, when you combine a lens that has OIS with a camera that has IBIS, you can get up to 6.5 stops of stabilization. The effectiveness of IBIS also depends on the camera. For example, here's the difference between an XH1 and the X-T4, showing how many stops of stabilization that you get with each lens. Now, the fourth kind of image stabilization is performed digitally in the camera's processor and is called digital stabilization. Many devices, such as smartphones, already have that form of digital stabilization built into them. The X-T4 actually offered two kinds of digital stabilization. One is a multi-purpose kind of overall general digital stabilization, and the other is called boost mode, which was very specific for if you're standing in one position, sort of panning to the right or to the left. However, in my opinion, in-camera processed digital stabilization as it is right now, it's a nice to have, but it definitely presents enough drawbacks that I would not use it in a variety of shooting situations. Look here how I used a 16mm prime lens with digital stabilization turned on. Have a look at the background right here. Do you see how it just kind of jumps and bends? It doesn't look right. The camera is trying to compensate digitally the camera shake while I was walking. I would have far preferred to have shot that footage without in-camera digital stabilization and instead brought that footage into post-production where I would have many more options available to stabilize the footage. So I have a few tips and suggestions for you. First, you really don't want to have image stabilization turned on if your camera is sitting on a tripod, right? If the camera is completely motionless because it's on a tripod, that is going to confuse the image stabilization mechanism, and it's going to constantly be trying to compensate, and you could actually end up getting less sharp photos. There is an exception to this that I know of, and that is the 16 to 80 millimeter lens. With that lens, you don't need to worry about this because it will automatically sense whether or not the camera is connected to a tripod. If you're shooting video and you are using the 50 to 140 millimeter lens and you have image stabilization turned on and you are recording your audio through the camera's built-in microphones, right, internally, then you may run into some issues where those mics may pick up the image stabilization noise that the camera lens is making. And this is particularly important if you're shooting in quiet locations. If you are shooting at a high shutter speed of, say, 1/1000th of a second or higher, or if you're shooting at a low shutter speed of, say, 1/15th of a second or lower, then I would not recommend turning on image stabilization. If you're shooting at very high shutter speeds, then you're not going to need image stabilization anyway. And if you're shooting at very low shutter speeds, then most likely your camera is stuck to a tripod, and you're not going to be needing in-camera processed image stabilization anyway. And lastly, and I wanted to save the most important advice to the end, image stabilization, IBIS, and digital stabilization have absolutely no effect on motion blur. If you're shooting at too low of a shutter speed at a subject that's in motion, you are going to get blur in your photo regardless of any kind of image stabilization system that you have turned on. Heck, even if you lock down the camera to a tripod and you go to take a photo at 1/15th of a second, you're going to find that no matter how locked down and motionless the camera is, your subject is obviously going to be out of focus, right? Subject motion. If you're shooting handheld candids of people, say with a 56 millimeter lens, I would probably not go below a shutter speed of 1/250th of a second. Remember that IBIS and OIS are there to help you with handheld camera shake, not subject motion blur. You always want to choose the correct shutter speed based on the motion of the subject that you're shooting. That is the single most important piece of advice that I can give you in this video, regardless of whether or not your camera has image stabilization or not. Well, I hope you enjoyed the video and found it helpful. And if you did, be sure to give it the like and subscribe. I will see you all again in another video real soon. Take care.